Penguin Random House Audio presents Baby of the Family by Maura Roosevelt. Read for you by Saskia Maarleveld. For my parents, Anne and Jim. I have watched you in the dark of a yard where we can only see each other by a lamp left on some rooms away. Two moths dust the same screen for remembered light. Jay Deshpande, on speaking quietly with my brother. When I was young and irresponsible, I was young and irresponsible. George W. Bush. Spring, 2003. It all started with a rowboat. Roger Whitby, Jr. 1. There was a time when the death of a Whitby would have made the Evening Post. Two generations earlier, flags would have been flown at half-mast and taps played in town squares at dusk. When Ethan and Ethel Whitby perished after their Buick collided with a logging truck on Route 9 in the Hudson Valley, just weeks after so many of their pals lost their lives on the Titanic, a special announcement thudded onto doorsteps just before 5. All across New York State and greater New England, women standing in their parlors shrieked at the news. Men hung their heads over their desks in sorrow, removing their hats for these leaders of industry, these strong-willed, big-toothed Americans. When the plane carrying Ethan's son William and his new wife plummeted into the Atlantic 2 days after their wedding, all the major magazine covers displayed the couple's youthful images, mourning the country's great loss. But when Roger Whitby Jr. died half a century later, there was no such hubbub. On the night that Roger died, his youngest child, Nick, was completely unaware of his father's passing. Nick did not receive notification by newspaper or even by phone. No, that night at midnight, Nick Whitby was off the grid. The 21-year-old had left his cell phone in his desk drawer in New York City and was now standing under the stars in northern Maine, shaking, about to commit an act of civil disobedience. As he beheld the construction site before him, Nick breathed too quickly and tried to muster up the fire, the fight that he needed right now. Metal scaffolding encased the concrete frame of a 6-story, half-built biotech lab, which was going up on the campus of Kennebec Valley Community College. He had done his research. The reports claimed that the lab would bring jobs to this empty expanse of rural vacation land. But Nick knew that it would also mess with the natural order of the world. Once the walls of the lab were up, scientists would sit inside of them and breed mice with human ears, or manipulate corn so that it grew 4 feet high in 2 months and gave everyone who ate it cancer. This building was just one more development feeding the tumor that was the neoliberal takeover of America and the greater globalized world. Civilization itself was going to shit. Things were at a tipping point, and somebody had to step up and resist the destruction. So there he was, in the middle of the night in Maine, in line with 8 other brave lunatics. He was taking a stand with a group of real anarchists from New York City. And as he took that stand, he couldn't help thinking about what a fraud he really was. God, he was such a nerd. Clouds of his breath pumped out too quickly, and everyone could see. Soon they would know that he'd never done anything like this before. The air was very cold, even in a wool sweater and black hooded sweatshirt with a beanie cap pulled over his forehead. He was freezing. For all purposes, April was still winter in Maine. But Nick knew from his childhood trips through the state to the Whitby family reunions that in a few short weeks, the sounds of bullfrogs croaking and crickets singing would emerge. He wished so badly for those sounds now, anything to cover up his huffs of panic. He was third in the line of people, and his comrades, or future comrades, as he was committed to showing he was just like them, were all dressed in similarly grungy jeans and winter hats, with bandit bandanas tied around their necks. There were no lights for miles. Above Nick, the sky was so clear and stars so bright that he could see the Milky Way. If he'd had time, he could have named every constellation. He was good at things like that. Big D, the lanky and unsmiling leader of this crew, the bearded man Nick had met only yesterday in the van on the way up, turned around and whispered harshly,
"You all right, brother? Kever's going first, and then you're up. As soon as he gets into the bucket of the crane, you need to start climbing."
Nick nodded but said nothing. Then Big D's hands were suddenly on Nick's biceps. The guy's breath was redolent of the garlic-heavy stir-fry the farm owners had made them for dinner.
"If you can't do this, walk away now. We need to act quickly once everyone is up there. If you're in, stay in. But if you're out, you need to get out, now."
"In,"
Nick barked too loudly, as if Big D were his drill sergeant. He focused on the machinery in front of him. It looked like one of those phone company cranes, but larger, and attached to a giant white construction vehicle. When he had agreed to be part of this action with this Earth Liberation Front group, he was told he'd just be a minor player, another body, a lookout. But when they'd gone over the plan on the 6.5-hour van ride up there, they collectively determined that Nick was one of the stronger and fitter individuals involved, and therefore he was needed to climb the crane. He still wasn't the most crucial person in the action. The short guy in front of him in the line, Kever, would climb up the machinery first and then jump down onto the roof of the half-constructed building. Then Nick would climb up and stay in the bucket of the crane. 5-gallon Poland Spring water jugs, half filled with ethyl alcohol, would be assembly lined up to him, and he would then drop them down into Kever's tiny arms. Kever would strategically place the jugs around the roof of the unfinished building, then tie each one to another in a spider-like web with gasoline-soaked rope cords. He would throw down the match, and they'd all flee the scene. On the ground, as Nick waited in line, some of the women were spray-painting the sides of the other construction vehicle. That's where Nick's friend Devorah was, in front of a dozer with a ferocious-looking shovel on the front of it, painting a communique note claiming responsibility for this action. The spray paint would read, "Biotech equals corporate control. Down with development. Fuck wage slavery. Stay wild. Elf." In the van on the trip up, Devorah had slept with her head in Nick's lap as they rumbled north on I-95. Nick was like a little kid at his first sleepover party, too excited and nervous to speak. This was the kind of adventurous life he'd been deprived of because of his freakish family, because of his adopted stepfather, Roger. Roger, when he was still his mother's secret boyfriend, hid Nick away at the hotel all those weekends of his childhood, then forced him to move out of New York and the only life he'd ever known. Because of Roger, Nick was always being taken away from something. He'd never had the chance to fit in, much less to be cool.
"Hey, you heard this one?"
Kever, sitting beside him in the van, asked in a southern twanged accent. His studded jean jacket with patches of old punk bands on it looked child-sized.
"Two anarchists walk into the bar. The bartender looks them up and down, sees their sneakers pulled from the trash, their homemade tattoos and ratty-ass sweatshirts. Then he asks these two dudes, 'What can I get for you?' And one responds,"
he made his voice deep and cartoonish,
"'That's not funny.'"
He slapped his leg, howling at the ceiling. Nick wondered if he'd misheard him. Was that a joke?
"And then the other, the other anarchist scoffs and says, 'That was so fucked up.'"
He kept laughing, so Nick chuckled too, quietly and politely. Devorah turned her sleepy face upward and mock groaned,
"Get it? Anarchists have no sense of humor."
Then she added, "Kever wants to be the first anarchist stand-up comedian."
the punk rock Jerry Seinfeld, he winked. But instead of talking about soup, I'll talk about, you know, smashing the state.
Nick laughed again, less softly. He was grateful someone even assumed he would get that joke. Devorah was the real reason that Nick was in that van at all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.